Then he shortly after that became an associate astronomer at Padua Astronomical Observatory, and then further to CISA. His research field includes stellar structure and evolution, stellar population synthesis, galaxy spectral evolution, and interstellar medium with a focus on dust creation from AGB and massive stars. There's much more things I could tell you about him, about the prizes he had received, acknowledgments, scientific acknowledgments. I just want to mention, among the other things, that in 2020, he was awarded the his paper, his Bressane et al. 2012, was the paper most cited in the last decade from MNRAS, and it's the paper about parsec, so what basically he will talk about. And before leaving the word to Sandro, he was my master thesis advisor, and so I must tell a story about that. So we were working on my thesis for 3 hours, a 3 hour or more session, and I was really struggling to try to keep up with what he was doing. And it was fast coding, programming, explaining things. And at the end, I was sweating and that tired. So he looked at me and he said, "Don't tell me you're tired. This is not work, this is fun." So I leave the word to Sandro. Thanks.
Okay, it's true. And I hope it will be so forever. Let me say. Okay. Do you hear me? Yes?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So the title here is funny in the sense that, let's say, it is 10 years that we published this paper on Parsec. And then I talk the 10 years after, which were let's say rock band in the 70, okay? So this is the title of one of the long playing, okay? Okay, so 10 years with Parsec. First of all, the outline. I will make a few highlight on some particular points, okay? Zero age main sequence, why it is important, new Parsec pre-main sequence model with accretion, work that is ongoing. As for the intermediate mass stars, disentangling, overshooting and rotation, in particular for the mixing. And then something that is a collaboration between, let's say, Gustavo, Stéphane Charlot, and the people from Padova, from Trieste, which is let's say spectral synthesis with binary stellar evolution. So let me see if I will be able to present all those topics. First of all, what is Parsec? Parsec is let's say Padova Trieste stellar evolution code. It is a stellar evolution code, a renewed version of the previous one, the one used in Padova, but it has been heavily modified. What I want to tell you here is that it is integrated in a suite where you can find, let's say, a lot of tools from Stellar Isochrones, which is the CMD tool, okay? Then a code that follow the thermal pulsing AGB evolution from the first pulse to the loss of the envelope. So we arrive at the first few pulses with the Padova Trieste stellar evolution code. Actually, we can go beyond, but it takes a lot of time. And then Paola Marigo developed this code to follow quickly this evolution. And then we have also a new part which concerned with volumetric correction table and code made by Cheng, which was a student in CISA, okay? So this is all integrated suite that you can find in this web page if you want to use, okay? It is you can use freely. So let me, first of all, let's say now go to the stars, the mass ranges we compute with Parsec. So we go from very low mass stars to very massive stars, from let's say 0.1 about to about 600 solar masses. And of course, we, let's say, focus on different properties of such star. We need to, let's say, have physics for all of this stuff. As for the metallicity, let's say we have produced a table for near solar metallicity, thin disk, bulge, spirals, and up to the large metallicity of early type galaxies. So the most massive one. Low metallicity for halo population, thick disk, satellite galaxies, small and large Magellanic Cloud, and then also very low metallicity for halo population, eventually dwarf galaxies, so zeta 10 to the minus 6, and so on. Up to now, always with solar partition of AV element based on Kafau et al., let's say, solar partition of elements, apart from some exception that eventually I will show you. And then we are, let's say, preparing for alpha enhanced partition. This is in progress. So I remind also some basic ingredients of Parsec. The important one is mixing, because we have core overshooting and envelope overshooting, turbulent diffusion, microscopic diffusion included, and also the rotation with geometry and mixing, okay? So let me go immediately to the Premain sequence evolution. You can see here the standard Premain sequence evolution in Parsec tracks. We use a starting model, which is an inflated configuration with a central temperature 10 to the 5. When we reach this central temperature, we let the star to contract under the effect of gravity, and the star actually, let's say, descend from the Hayashi line here and begin to burn the deuterium, and then it contracts until the contraction stops under the effect of the main nuclear burning. We define this point the, let's say, zero age main sequence. It you know, it is not an easy definition, because the model is not homogeneous. It is the let's say gravitational luminosity is not really zero, but anyway, it is this point that we define the zero age main sequence. But let's say once we define it, we have to characterize it and to see how it behaves when compared with the color magnitude diagram, the observed color magnitude diagram. And here is what we have seen for the first model we did. You can see that the low mass stars fail, here they are the blue and black tracks, fail to reproduce the observed lower main sequence in star cluster. It is an example for M67, and this is the first version of Parsec. Actually, let's say, it is not a problem of bolometric correction, or not entirely, not alone. It is a problem with the discrepancy between the predicted and the observed mass radius relation of dwarf stars. So here I show the variation of the difference, the relative difference between observed radii and the predicted radii. So let's say the observed are here and are underestimated by an amount which is about 8%. The problem is not only with Parsec. We tried to eliminate it, but it was not possible to eliminate, even by, let's say, using more adequate boundary condition, for example, from Phoenix atmosphere model, and we are here. It remained, let's say, discrepancy around the 5%. But here you can see Yale isochrones, the Yale model, they also are discrepant. And we have also the Dartmouth model, they are discrepant. I checked also recently the new Basti model, the discrepancy remained the same. And the problem is that these 5% originate this large difference between the observed, which is this one, the let's say the data, and the predicted main sequence, lower main sequence. So what we decide is actually to be pragmatic and say, okay, we apply a shift to the T tau relation of the Phoenix model atmosphere, a shift that is zero at a certain temperature around here, and then increases to 10-14% in the at lower temperature, in order to fit the observed mass radius relation of dwarf star. And this is what the result of applying this this shift to the T tau relation. You can see now that actually the radii are empirically reproduced, but not changing colors on other things, simply by applying a shift to the boundary condition T tau relation. So we use this shift as a calibrated T tau relation. This was done in, let's say, 14. And what is interesting is that the new zero age mean sequence obtained in this way, let's say, is able to match very well the data, for example, from Gaia, which is for the solar metallicity. Here is a, let's say, high precision observed color magnitude diagram of this cluster, 2516. But not only at solar metallicity, this is the main sequence of, let's say, 47 TAC, and the metallicity is 1/10 solar here in this case. But we didn't change the calibration. With the same metallicity, with the same calibration, we could fit all the, let's say, color magnitude diagram. I can show you recent result by, for example, Godi Rivera, Piesenolt, and Rebol, 21, where they use our, let's say, the parsec zero age mean sequence to fit the color magnitude diagram of open cluster to determine the so-called rotational sequences, namely by cross-correlating the data with the, let's say, the Gaia data with the rotational period derived from the monitor project, where they provide rotational period also, they could derive the rotational period at varying mass, and the mass was derived by fitting the data with parsec isochron and also, of course, the age. And here you see how the rotation changes with mass, let's say, at increasing age. Okay, here is the period. You see young ages here. Then as the age become about 150, you are here. And then, let's say, sorry, at 500, you are here. And then at, let's say, 700 mega year, you are here. And at, let's say, about 1 giga year, presiepe, you have this, let's say, increasing of the period, okay? So this is obtained only if you have calibrated main sequence. And in particular, those authors noticed that only parsec data, only parsec model could actually fit the data, the observed data. So if I look now, if I put in order of increasing age, let's say a few of color magnitude diagrams selected from the Gaia DR2, Bossini 19, I see that at very young ages, let's say at young ages, let me say 10 mega year, we have the, let's say, the sequence of the cluster is far from the zero age main sequence, but then it approaches it as the age actually increases, okay? So here is 44 mega year, 64 mega year, and 86 mega year. And let's say the cyan line is not a fit of the data, but it is an isochrome drawn with using the age of Bozzini et al. 19, where they actually fitted the data, but I derived myself the color and so on of this. So with a different, same age, but different, let's say slightly different approach. Well, and what you see is that it looks that the, let's say, stars move along line of constant mass, okay? Because those isochrones are drawn by Premen sequence evolution of constant mass, okay? We are now instead, let's say, trying to, let's say, derive new model with accretion, because accretion is something that is observed. And so one possible question is, on one side we have this indication that, let's say, the star move toward the, let's say, zero age main sequence at constant mass, and on the other we have evidence of accretion. So we have to, in a certain sense, combine the two things. Here I will be very brief and only, let's say, show you that we are producing such model. We have modified the Strucker equation by following Baraf, that actually describe the heat injection efficiency by means of this parameterization, this Xi, that take into account this one minus R star over the internal radius, and also the fraction of heat injection that is not actually the fraction of the efficiency of the accretion on the star. And then let's say, besides these let's say modification, we need also to specify where this energy must be deposited within the star. And actually, we use, we follow Kunimoto 17 to actually specify this function as a function of the radius. Simply, this simple formula tell that if A is a fraction between 0 and 1, the epsilon is 0 from the center to the relative mass 1 minus A, and it increases linearly with MR of M from, let's say, 1 minus A to 1, conserving the total luminosity. We started from that initial hydrostatic core of 0.05 solar masses, and we apply this accretion until the mass, let's say, reaches 200 solar masses. Of course, we need to specify the law of accretion, and here we have, let's say, several exponents in Hartmann 20. It is written, we read that the exponent may go from 1 to 3. We follow the prescription by MRD 19, and we used actually an exponent, a variable exponent between 1 and 1.8, let's say, by using E about 0.2, and let's say a constant in front of the, let's say, of the accretion rate of 1 × 10⁻, which is quite high. It is quite high, but let me show this plot to you. Actually, we start with an accretion rate which is not below 5 × 10⁻⁶. Otherwise, it is really, it takes a lot of time from 0.05 to reach this point here. When we reach 0.6, we use this accretion mass. And in fact, when M is equal to 1, is 1 solar masses, you see that M dot is 10⁻⁵. You can read here, no? You can read here the accretion mass in red. Sorry, the accretion rate, and here you in black you read the, let's say, logarithm of the mass. So we start at a constant accretion rate. When we reach 0.6, let's say this formula provides the accretion, which increases as the mass increases. Let's say here you see the position of the star along the line is correspond to the blue line, dashed line here. You see 0.6, 5 solar masses around the knee, and then here the main sequence you are at 20 solar masses. Okay, so the accretion increases. It reaches more than 10 to the minus 3 solar masses per year, several times, and the mass reaches 200 solar masses. When the mass reaches 200 solar masses, actually, we stop the accretion and we evolve the star under the effect of mass loss, which is the blue line. The blue line is the mass loss applied to the star when it starts burning hydrogen. This mass loss rate take into account that when the star evolves near the Eddington luminosity, the mass loss is enhanced following Vink 2011, and there are recently other, let's say, formulation of the mass loss rate, but this is one that take into account directly the enhanced mass loss rate due to the gamma ratio, L over L Eddington. And you can see that the mass loss rate may reach several times 10 to the minus 4 per year, okay? Okay, so the data that you see here are the, say, the sample of Herbig A, B stars by Vioc, and here you see superimposed our parsec isochrons. The only thing I wish to show you here is that, let's say, the effect of the exponent is clear. The larger the deposited energy and the more the star is inflated. And this has a certain impact, for example, in binary evolution. Because if the star has such large radii, okay, then the distribution of separation becomes dangerous in the sense that many of such stars evolving here should merge just before entering the main sequence, okay? So this is an example, for example. So the same is true for the, let's say, injection efficiency. Here you see from 0.1 to, let's say, the cold, evolution, which is essentially no injection, and if I see the effect of metallicity, in this case it is negligible for the module C equal 0.1 and the rate proportional to the mass to the 1.6. You see that there is no significant variation of the metallicity apart from the obvious zero age main sequence. Okay, so this is work that is still in progress to validate such pre-main sequence tracks before releasing them. But I repeat, this is an essential tool to be included in model that take into account binary evolution. Because of course, binary interaction may change the initial mass function if more massive stars begin to merge at a large rate because of, let's say, they inflate during the pre-main sequence. Now I go to, let's say, describe a bit the new steps done more recent year, which is including the rotation. The last 2 or 3 years, we have actually modified the parsec code to include the effect of rotation, both geometrical and the mixing effect. Here is an example. I show you also, let's say, the effect that is caused by the inclination angle. So when converting from theoretical to observed luminosity, you have to take into account, of course, also of the inclination angle. Okay, and this is shown in those two panels. But let me focus now on an important point. Both overshooting from the convective core, overshooting is the extra mixing caused by movement of, let's say, convective element beyond the stable region that causes certain mixing. So both overshooting and rotation participate to mixing, Okay, and so it is important to distinguish the role of the two, if possible. Up to now, up to before rotation, the mixing were entirely calibrated in terms of the shooting eventually. But now we have to take into account also that both of the shooting and rotation actually may contribute to that. So the best laboratory to date is the sample, a sample of the TH double line eclipsing binary, which you can see here in these two plots. Okay, the sample is from Claret and Torres. And you can see here compared with model with no overshooting and with a certain amount of overshooting, which is quite large. This lambda of is a parameterization in pressure scale light of the, let's say, extent of the overshoot. You can see that, let's say, the track changes a lot, in particular the main sequence widened while you increase the overshoot. And let's say, why such binary are an ideal laboratory? Because since they have the same age, okay, especially those that have near masses that are mass ratio that are near unity, they should occupy the same position because of the same age. And the different position in the color magnitude diagram on the theoretical diagram at the same age is caused only by difference in chemical composition, which is not the case if they are born in the same cloud, or by effect of mixing. And so we can hope that by checking those models, we can derive information on the agent of mixing. And in fact, Claret and Torres try to fit star by star. Let's say, I remind you that those binary are ideal because they provide us, let's say, with mass and radii, which are an accuracy of the 3% okay, level. And the effective temperature also is quite, let's say, well measured. 6%, and the metallicity within, let's say, 0.2 dex. So mass and radii are really well measured. And so they start making models of such star with MESA at given mass radius, and then they try to fit the position of the two star by varying the overshooting parameter. Since there was a lot of dispersion, they also changed the mixing line parameter. And they obtained this gray line here that you see here, okay? So an increasing overshooting until you reach a mass about two solar masses, and then a constant, a plateau in the mixing, in the extra mixing, with a dispersion which is not large, like the one you see here that we discuss in a moment. It is, let's say, a minor dispersion, but because they let the mixing length variable randomly change. Okay, so they found small overshooting dispersion, but a significant dispersion in the mixing length to be used with the star. So this is not easy to understand. Let's say if this is acceptable or not, in the sense that two star with the same mass, it is difficult, in my opinion, that the mixing length has such a dispersion. So we did instead another study, another analysis. We used a Bayesian analysis, letting the three parameters overshooting and age, but with a prior that the age of the two components must be similar, and we obtained such a kind of diagram, for example, for Alpha Aurigae, component one, component two, the overshooting value, and let's say the age, which is in this case, it is the same. And we could put in this diagram, let's say, all the stars. And you see actually that we have a significant dispersion. We have still an increasing overshooting, then on almost flat average overshooting. This green line is the one used in my previous models. No, it's not an average of the data. It is what I used before this paper, okay? But you see this large dispersion in overshooting parameter, which has been found also by Constantino Barath, 2018, even at the same mass, which is a bit disturbing. The important thing is that here you have very few objects, okay? And these correspond more or less with the overshooting parameter derived by, let's say, Claret, with this variation of the mixing length. So on the basis of this observation, we say, okay, why if, let's say, we use a fixed overshoot and we change the rotation? And this is the new analysis that we did. Indeed, we fixed lambda overshooting 0.4 and we used a variable rotation. So we computed new track set for different metallicity, different rotation. And let's say we let as free parameter omega, the rotation, and the age, always with the prior data, the two age of the component must be, let's say, equal. And we were able to reproduce the overshooting parameter, sorry, the data with a fixed overshooting parameter, and let's say a distribution, a uniform, almost uniform distribution of initial rotation at varying initial mass. And so we concluded that actually with this sample studied in the way we did, we could actually find the two contributions, the one by the overshooting, which is this 0.4, and rotation that is responsible of the residual, the additional mixing above that caused by, let's say, overshooting. This is an important result because it fixes for the first time the relative contribution on mix of the mixing between overshooting and rotation. And let's say I show you the case of Alpha Aurigae. Alpha Aurigae has an observed, let's say, value of 35 kilometers per second, Vucinae. And the model of Alpha Aurigae that we derived in this way, okay, with this method, predicts actually, let's say, for the secondary, let's say, a rotation of about 0.73. This omega is the ratio between the angular velocity and the critical angular velocity. And so at the beginning, the star had to rotate at this velocity, which is not negligible. In fact, if we need a velocity of the order of 35-40 kilometers per second, an initial, let's say, rotation larger than 0.5, that 50% is needed. And this is an independent Alpha Aurigae, the secondary component is here, and the model is this one, okay? And so, of course, the data, the model must be below, must be above the observation because of this Sinai, okay, here. So this is compatible with an inclination angle of about 32 degrees if the data and the model are taken at face value. But it shows that this star is actually rotating, and to have a rotation of 40, 35 kilometers per second at its temperature when it is evolved, okay, at between, let's say, 3.7, yeah, near 3.7, where the model actually is expanded and so the rotation decreases. At the beginning, it had to be, let's say, a fast rotator. So this is an independent confirmation that the interpretation of the mixing, the contribution by overshooting and, let's say, rotation is correct. And the same is true also for TZ for Dacis, which for which we have the same diagram. So important point here would be to have all the rotational velocity of such stars, okay? And try to repeat the analysis, including also the rotational velocity. I, let's say, now skip this other, let's say, to this other argument, which is the final part of the talk, and it is the collaboration that we have in Trieste, Padova, with let's say Morelia and IAPE in Paris. What we want to let's say do is to perform a spectral synthesis with binary stellar evolution. And so we, let's say, add, let's say, a code for binary stellar population synthesis to the spectral synthesis of Gustavo and, let's say, Stéphane Charbon. First of all, let me say that there are in literature several codes that, let's say, afford this problem. There are, let's say, codes that use analytic stellar evolution. They are listed here. Then they are actually code that integrate the stellar evolution on the fly. Of course, the first kind of model is much faster, but in a certain, especially for binary evolution, can be less accurate. Of this kind is the BPAS model and the very recent Poseidon from the MESA people. We use instead parsec stellar evolution track, we creating lookup table, and let's say we derive the binary stellar evolution by taking let's say input from such table, both in term of star or let's say quantities and as derivative of properties of star. So for example, this is a single star lookup table at solar metallicity. These are stars from 2.2 solar masses to 300. Actually, we go to 600, where you see the different phases. And here, the second part is the naked helium core. So they correspond to stripped stars or to homogeneous evolution, stars that secondary that accrete from the primary, and the accretion spin up them at let's say rotational velocity where they become homogeneous. And let's say here, this code, the code that follow binary stellar evolution is 7. I showed here the main author is Mario Spera, Mappelli. We also participate in providing tracks for the table. And let's say the binary process are all included with mass transfer, Roche lobe, accretion, quasi homogeneous evolution, common envelope, mergers, tide, gravitational wave decay. And here we have a list of phases. But in synthesis, what happens is the following. We start from the pre-main sequence, but a pre-main sequence which is near the zero age main sequence. Otherwise, with the distribution of, let's say, eccentricity and let's say semi-axis, we have the risk that many models merge before they evolve. Okay, so this is the problem I was referring before. With stellar evolution, we couple stellar evolution and binary interaction. We produce a blue supergiant, red supergiant, quasi homogeneous star, Wolf-Rayet of all type, and so on, post AGB. We have the final fate that may be total disruption, black hole, neutron star, white dwarf, but also we have accretion rate, supernova rate, and merging rate. Merging rate used to predict, to compare with gravitational wave detection. But let's say the other thing can be used to input in the spectrophotometric synthesis by Brugeois and Charlotte the data, and to get, let's say, the spectral synthesis. So now I wish only show, let's say, one representative result, which is this HR diagram, let's say, done for a low metallicity case. for single stellar evolution. Okay, you see the primaries, which in single stellar evolution, this is a distribution of star, okay, taken with a certain initial mass function, but in single stellar evolution, this is an isochron essentially. Okay, this is an isochron at an age of 3 mega year. And these are the secondary. But when we go to, let's say, when we include the binary evolution, the single isochron actually split in different components. These are the quasi homogeneous stars. You can see here stars that actually begin to produce ultraviolet radiation. Okay, even if at these ionizing radiation, even if at this age we don't have in the single stellar evolution and even later, and let's say this is taken into account to produce let's say the spectral synthesis code that I don't show you here because Gustavo is there and I ask eventually him to show you his result. So I go directly to the conclusion. This 10 year Parsec, we had a great success. I have to say that Parsec zero age band sequence is still now the best calibrated against the star cluster. And I show you that we can fit open cluster, solar metallicity, and also globular cluster. And actually, it is used to get masses and ages in the low mass star domain. The Gaia data release 2 premen sequence of the Young cluster is well fitted by non accreting premen sequence model. So it will be interesting to see how we can fit them with, let's say, accreting model. Something that I didn't show you is that at the same age, we have to reproduce evolution away from the main sequence at the turnoff and evolution toward the ZAMS in premen sequence. So this is, in a certain sense, a double check that without the lower main sequence, we cannot have. So new Parsec module accretion will be soon available, but after exploitation and calibration of main parameters. Instead, we have new Parsec. We have seen that new Parsec model with rotation are being released, and overshooting and rotational mixing seems to be well calibrated. A thing which is not, say, negligible, has not negligible importance. And finally, spectral synthesis binary stellar evolution is producing really stimulating results. Please ask Gustavo. Thank you very much for your attention.
Please. Thank you very much, Sandro. Let us start with questions inside the auditorium. Let's see some hands.
Yes, sir.
Go for it.
Could you say a bit about implement mixing in the stars? What kind of prescription do you use? And the second question is, how do you implement mass loss?
I cannot hear well your question. Did you wrote it somewhere or? Okay. So can you repeat, please?
Sure, I can try to speak up. You mentioned mixing in the middle of your talk. I'm interested in learning how do you implement mixing in the stars? What prescription do you use? Is it Eddington suite or do you have magnetic fields? That's question one.
No. Let's say we use a ballistic approximation. A ballistic approximation due to the fact that the bubble in always remaining in the mixing length theory, the fluid bubble are accelerated by buoyancy, but then the mixing length theory actually analyze the instability of the medium and not the velocity field. So we use a ballistic approximation that accelerate the bubble in the unstable region and then decelerate them in the stable region. It is a dynamic, let's say, it's not a simulation, but it is a description. okay? The bubble is accelerated and then it, let's say, overshoot from the unstable region. Normally, this distance of overshooting is parametrized with a fraction of the pressure scalite or density scalite, and this parameter, this fraction, is calibrated against observations, because there are no self-consistent theory that can predict this phenomenon. Is this was this your question?
Second question was, how do you implement mass loss?
Mass loss. Okay, mass loss is derived from let's say observation. There are theoretical approximation, theoretical. There are theory of mass loss. Essentially, you have the radiation field that is strongly peaked outward, and let's say the photons interact with ions. When they interact in fundamental line, let's say this interaction is a scattering, in the sense that the electron absorbs the photon, and after 10 to the minus 8 seconds, it re-emits it isotropically. So you have, before the interaction, that the radiation field is strongly peaked toward the exterior, and after the interaction, the radiation field contains isotropic photons, and so some momentum must be passed to the matter, okay, that absorbed. This is a way to accelerate. It is the so-called radiation-driven wind. It may happen also in presence of dust. If you have dust, dust can scatter, and the scatter is an isotropic scattering. Even in this case, for example, in the envelope of IGB star, asymptotic giant branch star, they are very extended envelope where the main free path of the photon become so large that the radiation is strongly peaked toward the exterior, and then dust actually absorb and re-emit or scatter the photons isotropically, even in this case, before and after the moment, the interaction, the momentum of the radiation changed, and so some must be provided to matter. Okay, so this is the way. The situation is much more complicated with respect to what I said. There are people that work in modeling stellar atmosphere. Their work is more difficult than modeling stellar evolution, because they need to work in non-local thermodynamic equilibrium. And so they are able to, they also have hydrodynamics for the acceleration of the wind. And so they enter with some parameter like mass, radius, luminosity, okay? And they, let's say, exit with a mass loss rate and a spectral profile. And fitting the spectral profile with the observation, they can tell you which is the mass loss that they predict with their model. Of course, in that case, mass loss is also dependent on the metallicity, if it is the radiation, if it is driven from radiation, like I told before. And so there is a relation between mass loss rate and the stellar parameter, mass, radius, luminosity, okay, and the metallicity, and we use the relation they provide us, taken from model and also calibrated on observations. Okay, this is the way we use mass loss.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ramandi. Do we have any other questions from Jakob? Go ahead.
Even though you mentioned it very briefly, is the AGB tip issue now well understood? Because I remember in the past years it was a matter of extremely strong debate, to say the less.
You mean the red giant branch tip?
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes, that one, the pulsation phase.
No, it remains an issue. Maybe I don't know if you are speaking of the tension that there is between the Hubble constant derived from the RGP and that derived from Planck result. The issue remains, and let's say we don't know who is right, because let's say the RGP tip, the accuracy with which is known is difficult to assess if, let's say, we need a lot of stars to be able to calibrate this RGB tip, okay? And in general, star cluster do not have enough number of stars to tell you, let's say, that the tip is exactly what is predicted by the model. Mm. Of course, with the new observation that will be available, we will have a lot of observations, a lot of, let's say, we will have also distances. This is another important point. We need accurate distances of a globular cluster, if you are speaking of the RGB tip. And we need to have such distances well known to really produce, let's say, good RGB tip. And also there is another point that I have not mentioned here, that you don't measure the luminosity of the RGB tip. You measure a magnitude within a passband. And this depends on the effective temperature, on gravity. Okay, and in turn, this depends on the mixing length you are using. And why the mixing length is calibrated on the sun, it is not sure that, let's say, this mixing length work well also in star cluster, in the red part of the star cluster. In fact, there are papers that claim theoretically a variation of the mixing length with the temperature, with the effective temperature, the luminosity. Okay. A paper by Asplund, they investigate the issue of the mixing length derived from three-dimensional hydrodynamic model and cast into one-dimensional stellar evolution model. Mm. So it is not certain. I think the issue is open.
Okay. Thanks, Jacopo. Any other questions from the auditorium? If not, let's see some hands on Zoom if you have any questions. Okay, Lee, please go ahead.
So I just have a comment, which is that it's excellent to see that you're doing the accretion for intermediate mass stars. I think that's great. It's well overdue.
Okay, thanks. Actually, we hope to extend it to massive stars also, of course. What I spoke of intermediate mass stars, but in reality, what we are doing is from intermediate to massive stars. But I hope to really finish this paper because it is always interrupted by several other duties that I have. So, and it is not simple because I introduced at least three new parameters. Okay, efficiency of the accretion that you have to put in the star, the accretion rate in term of exponent and of zero constant. These are three parameters that you need to calibrate with observation. But I am pretty confident that observation will tell us really very much things in the near future about that.
Yes, because there's not really any good theory for how much thermal energy gets put in. You know, that part hasn't been calculated, right?
Yeah. Thanks for your comment.
Okay, thank you, Lee. We have a question from Nuria.
Yes, I have. Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, I just was wondering this T of tau, the T effective tau relation that you had scaled, right, in order to fit the ZAMs, if I understood correctly. How do you explain it physically?
This is really a good question. We use this shift because we are not able to explain it. Okay? This is the point. we try model with dark spot to see. Uh-huh. In a certain sense, radiation must be must be blocked in such a way the star expand more. Okay.
Yeah.
So there must be some way to block radiation and to expand more. I have also a naive explanation, but I have not the, how do you say? Okay, the naive explanation could be some strange effect of dark matter. Because if there is some coupling between dark matter and baryonic matter, you don't see at the luminosity of the sun. But at the such low luminosity, which are 1,000 less than that of the sun, even a small interaction, even a small amount of excess energy, you could see there. So this is something that should deserve a real investigation.
Yeah,
the problem is, the real problem is that we have so many things that we don't know precisely, like, for example, the metallicity of the stars. If you have to compare, for example, I will compare dwarf in a certain region of the halo and in another region of the halo, where the dark matter density is different, for example. But dwarf are very difficult to see when they are distant. Maybe with the WST, this could be done, okay? And then you have to know the metallicity of such stars. So it is really a challenging problem. But up to now, there is no explanation of this excess of this difference between the observed and the predicted radii. There is simply no explanation.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nuria. We have time for one more question, if anyone has any. Okay, if not, I have a question, actually. Hi, this is Sundar. I was wondering about the the values of the overshooting parameter based on observations. I was wondering what the main source of the huge uncertainties was.
Sorry, the second part is not, I didn't hear.
I was wondering what the major source of the uncertainty was in the, from the lambda overshooting based on the observations. The uncertainties were huge.
The uncertainty is because, let me go there. But not all are, you have, the problem is that you can see here, no? This is a Bayesian estimator of the possible value in the case, for example, of alpha Auriga, the first component. So it takes into account all the uncertainties that you have in, let's say, mass, radius, effective temperature, and also metallicity. Hmm? This is the point. I would say that you are right, but let's say this is what came from the analysis of the observation. If we have more precise masses and more precise radii, then, and of course also effective temperature, you see, effective temperature is, let's say, is here, okay? So 6% is not small. If you have better observation, in particular if you could have observation of velocities, rotational velocity of such stars, then we would have a better estimate. It is not in the model, because the model by default they do not have uncertainties.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much. All right, let's thank the speaker again for a very interesting talk.
Oh, thank you. It was a pleasure for me.